Good morning, church. Welcome this morning to our time of worship on this beautiful Labor Day weekend. We're going to continue on with what you're doing and making a welcome time and greeting one another. Just wanted to point out, I think there's a family on the front row. Oh, he's working his way in. There's a family on the front row. They haven't been here for a while. So make sure you greet them and give them a hug this morning and welcome Pastor Joe and Tracy back. Take 90 seconds and say hello to each other this morning. Thank you. All right. Thanks, everyone. We're going to head back to our seats now, and you all can have a seat. Thank you very much. Christine, if you'll get the lights for us, we're going to look at some announcements this morning as we get started to this morning. So take your worship folders with me, and we will look at some announcements very briefly this morning. So if you haven't had a chance to sign up for 242 groups yet, those are starting next week and the following week after. So our small groups, our 242 groups meeting in folks' homes on certain Sunday evenings, those three are listed there. There's some QR codes there that will tell you about the literature, and you can sign up for those at the Welcome Center or in the table in the back. Wednesday night, our regular evening Wednesday evening services will begin again. The youth will have their midweek kickoff there, so there are some instructions there as well. Also, I believe there's a new program, mission scouting program for the kids on Wednesday evenings. So mark that down on your calendars as well. I think in your worship folder there's a sign-up sheet or a QR code you can use to sign up and follow some instructions for those kids in kindergarten through sixth grade. So mark those down as well. On Sunday, the 24th of September, there's a picnic coming up in McClung Park. So bring a side dish and a friend and make sure to show up for that Sunday at McClung Park. And then I saw on Facebook this week, and you can see a little bit about that in your worship folder, there's a new website that's coming out. So I'm sure it will have all kinds of bells and whistles that Amanda and the team have put together for us. So keep your eye out for that as well. Betty, I believe you had an announcement this morning.
First of all, you're all invited to a luncheon after church. I know that y'all know that, but I'm hoping that Pastor Joe and Tracy didn't know that. We were able to keep a secret from you. You got into Amanda's directory, her book the other day, her management book.
I did.
Keep out of her book. Okay.
I had an urgent question that had to be answered.
Yes, I know you had an urgent question. You wanted to know what was going on here at the church. It's only been 3 months, and we're not letting you go again. But we are so appreciative that you've had this time away. And we're presenting you with the key to, I'm not the mayor, I can't give you the key to the city. You already have a key to the church. And so this says, presented to Pastor Joe E. Gregory and wife Tracy Gregory in honor of your love and dedication to First Church of God, Jefferson City, through your sabbatical summer of 2023. And we are giving you the key to our next steps in our church, where we are going. I warned Amanda that when you got back, we would have to put a seatbelt on you, because we know you are ready to go. But Pastor, we are thrilled that you are home with us. And it has been signed by many here, and we may need to have it out. I don't know if we got everyone, but we may need to allow other people to sign the back of it, just so you would remember who was here when you weren't.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
There's a story of a preacher who went out for chicken at the local Lee's Chicken. And it was a strange story, because when he went up there to order his meal, the woman said, "I'm sorry to inform you, but we're all out of chicken." He was completely startled by that news and said, "Really, how could you be out of chicken? That's your main course." And she said, "Well, we just did. The shipment was overlooked. But we have everything else. We've got tea, biscuits, gravy, mashed potatoes, and green beans." He says, "But I want the main course." You see, that's the danger for us today, is the main course here is Jesus. May it not be said that we left this building today without having an encounter with him. You see, the music, the preaching, the fellowship, those are like biscuits and gravy. But the Spirit of God is the main attraction. So can we pray and ask God's blessing on our meeting today? I mean, I don't know about you, but I feel we need God's touch on our lives in every way. Let's do it. Father, thank you for bringing us together again. Thank you for being so faithful to us. We acknowledge that you are the faithful one. You are the righteous one. And so today we want to welcome you here in this room. We want to welcome you in our thoughts, our hearts, our lives. May you be the main attraction of everything here that takes place today. Because we need to feed on you. We need to hear from you. We need your presence. And so we welcome you, and we ask all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's stand together and begin with a great anthem that we all know, Christ Alone. Let's sing this out this morning.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when the fears are still, when striving cease. My all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came. Death of Christ I live. there in the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain, then a bursting forth in the glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
I'm reminded of these words in the book of John this morning in chapter 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away. The wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned and free.
Lift him up.
Jesus paid it.
be seated this morning.
Is it a joy and an honor to be able to take communion today to celebrate the Lord? And if you did not pick up the elements, if you wouldn't mind maybe raising your hand, we've got some gentlemen that will be happy to have. If you'll keep your hand up, Brother Steve, there's some up here in the front. And if you wouldn't mind maybe going ahead and preparing it by opening up the top, taking the bread, and then simply turning it over and then opening up the top. Before we actually take, let me read a passage of scripture from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup." We're going to give you just a few moments, just between you and the Lord, to pray. If there's anything between you and the Lord, that you would clear that up. And then we're going to take the Lord's Supper together. Let's spend some time together as Brother Kevin plays on the piano. Our Father, we come here in this sacred time at your wonderful invitation to the Lord's table. We give you thanks, Lord Jesus, for your body again that we're reminded of was broken and bruised on our behalf. For the blood, the cleansing blood of Jesus that was given on our behalf that makes us clean and pure in your sight. That has brought us redemption and healing and salvation. So we remember you today, Lord Jesus, and we proclaim your death until you come again. In your holy name we pray. Amen. The body of the Lord. And then his blood. We'll stand together and let's sing together the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him.
Father, today we continue in prayer. We give you thanks that we can come to you at any time and in any place and circumstance. We've come here today on this Lord's Day as the body of believers that meet here at 1614 Southwest Boulevard, to lift up our praise and our thanks to you. We acknowledge that you have been good and merciful and kind to us. Wow, when we think about your long suffering, we are grateful. And we've come today to worship you, to know you, to learn of you. We're also here today to cast our cares upon you. We have various needs that press us sometimes very deeply and hard. Some of us have some health concerns. Some of us have some health concerns for loved ones. Some we have some financial concerns, relationship tensions. We even have some struggles with sin and temptation. And we are thankful that we can bring all of these needs to the cross, where there is grace and mercy in our time of need. So you know our hearts. You see the things that are going before us even now, and we bring those to you. And we pray that they will all be met in the name of Jesus. We pray for the rest of this service, the things that will be shared, even our children's ministry and the things that have been shared, even in Sunday school, the seeds that have been planted to our fellowship. May it all bring honor and glory to God. And we even close this prayer time today by praying together the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. We offer this up to you, Father. And church, would you pray with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated.
Bestows every day.
sweeter he grows.
As I start this morning, there is a passage of scripture that I really want you to remember. It's the words that Jesus spoke in a very crucial time in his earthly ministry. It's actually in the Garden of Gethsemane, where I actually think the biggest battle took place is what was before him. And he prays what is known as the priestly prayer for you and I. And it's this verse, John 17, verse 3. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Will you pray with me? We come today, Father, completely dependent upon you today. Speak into this, the heart of our lives, into the heart of this congregation. Again, in ways that only you can speak. We pull ourselves away from the noise of the phones and life and its demands to hear your still, small voice speaking to us. We pray this in the name of Jesus. And everyone said together, amen. First of all, today I'm just really going to share with you some things from my heart that God was so kind and loving and gracious to bring to me. First of all, I want to just thank you, this congregation, for this amazing gift of 3 months of a sabbatical. To the board, who worked really over a year ago in the discussion and plans to implement this in the life of our church, that it would come about for the pastor. I appreciate those of you that filled in the gap. From leading Wednesday nights to Scott, who led the youth class, to Kevin, who stayed faithful and even asked Laura to fill in the gap with the music, and just a real blessing that Amanda is to the church, who picked up a lot of work in the office, and then Betty, who, you know, between Betty and Amanda, they're like the Thelma and Louise team that got things done, and they are sanctified and saved, Thelma and Louise. But a real special thank you to Clovis, who did some hospital visitation, and to many others that covered so much. I'm very deeply grateful. To start out with, in general, I was kind of like driving 90 miles an hour right before I left. The pace, the speed, the activities, I felt like I was driving that way and heading for a cliff, to be quite honest with you. With us entering into our 100th celebration and our 100 outreaches, everything from the homecoming to the hymn sing to just the life activities, from the death of Mike Nash to his funeral, to Grace Mosier getting married, to my son preaching his first sermon, to him graduating from high school, to open house, to our family coming When I left and started on June the 1st, I was in a double bind. I felt extremely guilty the first 2 or 3 weeks that I wasn't doing anything. And I didn't have the motivation to do squat. I found myself sitting on our back porch and sometimes on our front porch alone, simply just staring. Unpacking, inwardly slowing down. And it took me a while, to be quite honest. That's why the gift of 3 months is great. You hardly get that done in 2 weeks. I'm just being honest. Emotionally, spiritually, and even physically. The third week in June, our family took off for Florida. We went for several reasons. The first reason was the Church of God Convention was in Tampa, Florida this year. It's every other year. I go as a privilege to represent this congregation as your pastor in what is known as the General Assembly, where they make decisions about the culture, financial decisions, all kinds of things. It also was the reason I had the privilege of leading the Church of God Heritage Hymn Sing, which was a real joy. I also want my kids to go and be a part of that kind of an atmosphere. I'm also really proud of my wife and my kids because I get to go back and see all these people that are just shocked that I'm married and got 3 kids. Yeah, Kathleen is one of them. She's up here on the front row. And got to fellowship with brothers and sisters and go to the alumni reunion and all of these kinds of things at the Church of God Convention and hear some great speakers and great music. We got to go to Sarasota, Florida as a family of 5 and stay in, what's those things called, A&B? Is that what they're called? Yeah. A whole house with 3 bedrooms, 15 minutes from the beach, and we spent about 3 days at the beach. And we would walk in the evening and just took in the sights and the sounds. You'll find this very funny. I didn't find it funny at the time. We rented a car because our cars are like, you know, covered wagons. And I was a little afraid to take our cars all the way to Florida. And so we rented this car that was brand new. It had all the bells and whistles. It only had 5,000 miles on it. And I barely get down the street on Missouri Boulevard and I'm trying to adjust the steering wheel, and I couldn't figure out how to do it. And there's this little button on the steering column that says plus, and there's a little button on this side that says minus, and I'm thinking, well, surely that's not it. And I hit it, and all of a sudden, bam, I'm knocked down to first gear. And I can't get out of first gear. And everybody's behind me trying to, you know. And I finally get to a stoplight. I'm thinking, man, this car is broken already. And I finally get to a stoplight, and I put it in park. And whatever I did, it cleared it. On the way to Florida, I'm using my cell phone for directions. I kind of knew how to go, but just to avoid any kind of traffic snares that you might come across. When all of a sudden, the woman on my GPS, she's now talking to me through the entire car system. I get a telephone call and we're not even sure how to answer or how to hang up. And on the way back, this fangled car, it starts dying on me. I come to a stop and it starts shutting down. I'm thinking, oh no, there's something wrong with the car. And so you ought to see me here in Nashville traffic on the way back at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm really pacing it so that I don't have to come to a complete stop because it's wanting to die. And so when I get back to turn in the car, I'm saying, they want to know how the car was. I said, well, the car needs some repair work because something is amiss. It keeps dying every time I come to a stop sign. Well, sir, it's supposed to do that to save on gas. Tracy and I later on in July were able to go away for the first time to an A&B at Hannibal, Missouri, and spend a weekend there alone, which was great. We actually had the time and the focus to take all 3 of our children and systematically talk about their lives, what's before them, and make a prayer list that we're going to pray for them for the next year. We used to do that. My sister-in-law came, my wife's twin, with her two children, a two-year-old and a five-year-old, and they stayed, was it 8 to 9 days? And that very week, our alternator goes out on our van, our sweeper breaks, and our shower breaks. You know, life's issues that you all face. And I found myself, when my wife and her sister would go out for coffee, I was the one that got to babysit. And what was shocking to me I actually got on the floor and played with my nephew who's 5 and my niece that's 2 with blocks and cars, and I made videos and sent them to their dad and to their mom, and I thought, you know, I never would have done that before. I didn't have the emotional wherewithal to do it. My daughter actually forgot, and she put one of her necklaces in one of her blue jeans, and it got washed in the washing machine, and when it came out, it was an entangled mess. I actually sat there for 30 minutes and untangled it for her, and they even noticed, Dad, you never would have done that before. No, I would have pitched it. Do you understand? And the greatest thing was I got to spend unhurried time with God. And I discovered he's amazing. He actually meets with you. This great God of the universe that even knows the number of hairs on our head wants to meet with us. And I knew that, and I experienced that in times past, and I've been going meeting with him, but it's been such a task, and it's been such a schedule, and I didn't realize unhurried time with God, what it can do. And I began to pray that God would change me. That's kind of a scary prayer. One of the things I also got to do was I got to go to the Healthplex down the street 6 days a week. I'm up to almost 15 miles a week running and jogging. And listen, I've been doing that since I left. And will you help me still continue to do that? I need to do that. I read 4 Christian novels and 4 books on ministry. And I read the bibliography of John Wesley, the founder of the church, the Methodist Church. But my greatest time was with God. And I'm going to share with you just a little personal thing that I hope you hear my heart about. One of the books I was reading is a brand new book called The Praying Church, written by Paul Miller. Chapter 6 is called Feed the Saints. And it starts off by talking about how in this culture that we live in, oftentimes churches can get real caught up with themselves. And so we preach about us, what we're doing, all the things, the activities, and we want to attract people to us and to the church. And his premise is that you've got to preach the word, and how pastors can get so caught up into something that can catch them completely unaware. And I'm reading this kind of intellectually. And this author, his father, was a fantastic pastor. But he shares in this chapter a letter that his mother wrote to her husband. And I read the letter. I'm going to read it to you. It was as if the letter had been written by my wife, Tracy. And I was blown away. I write this to you today with love, but I have noticed that the church and the mission of the church is consuming your time and energy. It's the ministry that seems to be the source of your deepest joys and your greatest fears. You nourish and cherish them as a bridegroom does his bride. When we wake up in the morning, your thoughts are usually on the church, discipleship groups, neighbors, church, your writing, your staff team, your teaching, and your preaching. Your daytime energies are directed at these, and at night, they're still with you. I don't mean to imply that you're doing all of this in the flesh. No one could do all these things unless empowered by the Holy Spirit. I am saying that as I study Ephesians 5, I read that there is a holy energy that goes into a marriage from the husband to the wife. The other day when I asked if we could go have tea together or just go out, I wanted to say some of these things to you face to face, but your response was, I thought that we had enough problems. I forgive you for making the church and the mission your first love. But I'm not sure that I'm helping you by keeping quiet. I have learned to accept this as the way of life, but is it really God's norm? You often say that you want to be a man controlled and compelled by the promises of Scripture, a man of prayer and patient and a perpetual learner. God is making you all of this, but I rarely hear you share your desire to be taught how to nourish and cherish your wife as Christ cherishes the church. God revealed to me an idol in my life. It's my calling and my ministry and this church. It's not anyone's fault, but my own. And when I read that letter, I mean, it was like a huge light went on. It's like, wow. And a day later, I got my wife alone together. We sat on the love seat there in our living room, and I read the letter to her. I didn't get halfway through, and she's crying, and I'm crying. And I apologized to her. I've let other things consume me. Now, I just want to affirm to you, Tracy, I've said this before. Everybody in this room I see black and white, but you I see in color. There's going to be a change because of repentance of it. I hope you understand my heart. I talked to the young people this morning. We study the prodigal son, all 16 of us. We always concentrate upon the son that left, but did you ever catch the son that stayed? This is Joe. I fear that it might be some of you. Oh, and God forbid that my kids come up with this. We look at Christianity as something that is performance-oriented. If I do the right things, if I don't do the wrong things, if my kids come to youth group, if I go to church, if I do this, if I do, that's what that oldest son was doing. Dad, I've done all these things for you. See, he was performing. How many of you that know that nobody has performed correctly except Jesus? I am broken. You are broken. There's no remedy but Christ and Christ alone. And then I began to pray after this revelation, God, oh my word. And see, and here's what I thought. I thought, I go on this sabbatical, and I've taken 8 books. I only read 4. I took 8 books on ministry. And I thought, how many books did I take to read about how to be a better husband? 0. This is what I'm talking about. I thought about my prayer life. Listen, folks. When I come to pray about you, I pray about everything. I pray about the governance board members by name, the staff. I pray for Kevin. I pray for every youth in this church by name. I pray for our finances. I pray for our prayer life. I pray for us to have a spirit of worship and a spirit of praise, a spirit of unity. I pray that God will use us. I pray that God will bless. There's about 8 men in this church that I pray for by name daily, that God will do a work in their hearts. And I'm doing all this praying, and I'm thinking, how much time am I praying for my wife? Do you understand? So then I began to say, God, how many of you grab that God is faithful to complete the work that he started in us? So then I began to say, God, you're going to have to change me. And I'm asking God that you do these things in the life of the church. I'm asking that you do bless the church. I'm asking that you do bless my wife, our marriage, our children. I'm asking you bless our finances. You see the things that we're up against, God. You know my kooky history. You know my kooky way of doing things. Yeah, God, I need your favor on all of this. I'm praying for this and that and this and that. And finally it dawned on me. And listen, I finally got to the place of saying, God, I'm just telling you right now, if you don't favor my kids, if you don't favor my marriage, if you don't give favor to this church, if you don't give favor to my finances, if you don't give favor, if you choose not to give your grace in any of these requests, I have one request of you, God. And that is that I would know you. That I would know your voice. That I would know your fellowship. That I would know your heart. That I would know your presence when I'm with you alone, when I'm sleeping, when I'm driving, when I'm with people, when I'm on this stage, when I'm in my office. God, that I would know you. Say no to all of it, but say yes to that. Yes to that. Because I don't want to miss knowing you. And that's my prayer for us. We can get so contented with church and our traditions and about us, and we can leave here on Sunday morning and never really know God. I'm not talking about knowing him, about knowing facts about him. I know about Bill Gaither, but I don't know him. Know him and his presence. That's my greatest need. This is what Paul said. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. This is why I bring this verse to you. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only one true God. And I love this Old Testament passage. This is what I'm saying to God. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vine, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stall, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. I got to be happy in God, not what he can do for me. not what he can give me. I want to rejoice in knowing him. I tell you what, as you know, Jonas went off to school this summer. Being a man, I'm always kind of like, you know, grow up. How many of you saw him, Andrew? So I've just been kind of cool about this whole thing. Partly because of just the schedule and everything you got to do, from ACT test to application to money to jobs to you understand. I got on this sabbatical, and in the middle of it, I'm sitting down with Jonas, and we're going to look on his email on the College of the Ozarks portal for him. I told this to Kevin this week when he and I had lunch, and we get on there, and there's an email, and he opens up the email, and the email is his class schedule. My first instinct, I got to get my day planner and write this down so that I can help him navigate through this. I mean, I've been doing this 18 years. And just a split second, it said, Joe, you're not needed to do that anymore. But I thought, wow, where'd the 18 years? We talked to him Thursday night, and he said, listen, Dad, we had him on speakerphone, and I'm off this weekend, because they're there at the College of the Ozarks. If you don't know it, they have workstations where they have to work, and so he's working in the cafeteria, and he has every other weekend off, so he's got this weekend off, and he said, so do you mind if I come home? It's your first day back to church. Can I come home? Yes. And I thought, you know, I'd ask Tracy, how are you doing with Jonas gone? I miss him. I miss him too. And you've all, many of you have done this, but I'm telling you this story because this doesn't even compare to God wanting to see you. His heart to long to be with you, to know you, and to love you. Is your greatest desire to know God? Is your greatest desire, your treasure is him, not what he can do for you? Is that where you are? I pray by God's grace that that happens in you and happens with me, and it's got to be almost like a continual thing. How many of you know what I mean? How many know there's all kinds of vices out there to get in your way? Maybe you've come to church and you've never really surrendered or given your life to Christ. And again, you know about church. You know what's expected. You could probably write it all down. But do you know him? You see, it's knowing God that true ministry comes forth. If we want to see God do a great thing in our church, it's not our programs. It's not even our staff. And by the way, I'll just tell you, I shared this with Kevin too. We went to 5 churches here in Jefferson City, and I would have picked this one as our church home anytime. And I don't mean that critically. We went to some pretty big churches. 3 big churches. One church twice, and nobody spoke to us. No one shook my hand. No one greeted me. No bulletin. No information about kids. Nothing. And so we can go to church, but does that actually mean that we know God? We've talked about this before. Those horrible words that the lost will hear on the day of judgment: depart from me, you doers of iniquity, for I never what? I never knew you. So ministry is not the band. It's not the slickness of the lobby. It's you and I being one-on-one with God. That's what attracts people. What do you think they're looking for? They're looking for a relationship with God. That's what we're made for. And it's being authentic, not just hypocritical, not just two-faced, or not just this way on Sunday, but that this is your life. You minister. We will minister out of knowing. This is why I worship. It's to know Him. This is why I pray. It's to know Him. This is why I do what I do with reading the Bible. It's to know. It's not to get brownie points. It's not sort of some sort of a list. It's to know Him. It's to know Him. And see, once you know Him, you're not going to be able to do anything else but love Him. And see, this is why it's important for you to know God and to get with Him. John Wesley said this: you will not be able to love God if you don't come to the understanding of His love for you. You cannot love someone who does not love you. If you think God is mean, tyrant, distant, you will approach Him that way. But if you begin to understand this amazing God who loves us, it will revolutionize your life. So I'm asked, that's my last prayer and my wrap up. God, would I understand your love for me? I don't know. I'm a broken person. I've got so many hindrances from my life experience and father wounds. I'm just so weary of it. But the truth of it is, it's blocked me from being able to understand God's love for me in many ways. But how many of you know God can overcome that? I'm asking Him to. I don't know how to. I'm not a therapist. But I'm asking Him to just show me, not so that I can just be comfortable, but so that I will love Him. See, the Bible says we love Him. Why? Because He first loved us. So, today I'd like for us, I've asked Kevin to just lead us in a song. But if your desire, if your need, is to understand and know God better, more intimately, we're going to ask that we come forward, and we're just going to ask God to do this work. The fact that we're even talking about this is a work of God. So He evidently wants, and here's the other thing. This is what's so cool about God. Who He is, He wants to give me favor in my marriage. He wants to give favor to this congregation. He wants to. It's the point of, do we want Him above those things? Will you stand together? Our Father, today, we've simply come together to share our hearts and to hear from You. So we are grateful that You are a God that is relational and wants to know us. And we pray today that we might respond to Your promptings. There's a lot of changes, yes, that need to take place in our life. We can't do those. We can't be good enough. We can't cross all the T's and dot all the I's. But Jesus did all that for us. So help us to rest in Him and be in Him today. And bless our time as we come before You today. We pray this in the name of Jesus. And everyone said together, amen. Kevin's going to lead us in this song, Change My Heart, O God. We're just going to make it all open. Those of you that want to come, come and pray. And even the singing of the song can be a prayer to God, corporately and individually. But if you'd like to come and pray, feel free to pray. And let's join Brother Kevin and the team as we sing together this song.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh
maybe just holding hands and even across the aisle, and